I don't hear anything now, I confess.
Is it on?
I don't hear absolutely anything. So should I start? I mean, do you hear me? I don't hear anything.
No, no, it's not registering.
Okay. Margherita, can you hear us?
Now yes, before I couldn't hear
Okay.
anything.
So very many thanks for agreeing to speak, and I think you can go.
Okay, thank you. I was waiting for that. Okay, so thank you for the invitation, and I'm very sorry I couldn't be there in person. Okay, so I'm going to talk today about the nonlinear supersymmetric hyperbolic sigma model on a complete graph with hierarchical interactions. And what I'm going to talk about is joint work with Silke-Rolles and Franz Merkel. So let's start with the model. Hopefully, just stop me if I start writing too small or you don't hear me any longer. Okay, so let's start with the model. So to make things clear, I will start with the model on ZD, and then we will go to the hierarchical case. So to construct the model, what we do, let's first fix a family of weights associated to each pair of points. So I different from J, ij in ZD, and a family of positive weights associated to each vertex, j in ZD, where so it is a family of parameters fixed. And what we assume is that wij equal wji, so we are looking at undirected edges. These are all non-negative parameters. And we assume that the sum over j, wij, is finite for all i. And we also assume that if we define e, the sum of all the undirected edges, such that wij is strictly positive, this set is a connected set. Then G, which is ZD together with this edge set, is a connected graph. So, for example, take just wij to be positive only for nearest neighbor edges. For the epsilon, all we need is that the epsilon j are all positive or zero, and at least one is positive. There is at least one j0 such that epsilon, well, actually, it's enough to say that the sum, so they must be summable, sum over j, epsilon j is finite. Well, no. I will get to this. No, it's enough that there is at least one epsilon j, j such that epsilon j is strictly positive. Actually, that's enough. Okay, so now with these parameters, I want to construct my model. It is a kind of spin model where the spins take values in a strange space. Okay, so fix some finite volume. So let's take lambda. Some finite, typically a cube, a finite cube in ZD. And to construct the spin model, we have to define a spin configuration. So I want to define a spin configuration. So this is a function mapping lambda into some space. And for each j, vj is the spin at position j. Now, for vj, we take a vector with three real and two Grassmann components. So x, y, and z are real, or more generally, they are even elements in a Grassmann algebra. And psi and eta are Grassmann variables. Or more generally, odd. So either you take the generators or some odd elements in the Grassmann algebra. So the space we are acting on is R 3, 2. Because there are three bosonic and two fermionic variables. To construct a spin model, we have first to, we have some linear space. On this linear space, we have some bilinear form, and we use this bilinear form to introduce some nonlinear constraint. Okay, so we need a bilinear form. So I take P, P prime, and this scalar product equals x, x prime plus y, y prime minus z, z prime plus xi, eta prime minus eta, xi prime. So you see that this first part, this is really Minkowski scalar product. And we have an additional part coming from fermions. So in particular, if I take the scalar product V equal V prime, so if we take V, V, what we obtain is x squared plus y squared minus z squared plus 2 xi eta. So this is not a positive definite bilinear form. Still, we go on, we add now a nonlinear constraint. So, sorry, I need to, oh. Okay, so nonlinear constraint. So if this was a classical O(n) model, then the spin would take values on the surface of a sphere. So the nonlinear constraint would be that the norm of the vector equals 1. So here we have something similar. The norm of the vector equals minus 1. So V, V equals minus 1. So if you forget the Grassmann variables, that means we have a time-like vector. Okay, with these constraints, z is now a function of x, y, psi, and eta. So z equals plus minus 1 plus x squared plus y squared plus 2 psi eta. Oops, square root. And actually, we have to choose one of the two halves, so we will choose the plus part. So if you once again forget the Grassmann variables, what we are constructing is the hyperbola, H2. Since we have in addition the Grassmann variables, what we have is a supersymmetric extension of the hyperbola. So Vj leaves on the nonlinear space H22. And that's at the, this model is generally called the H22 model. Okay, now now I have my spin. I want to construct a Gibbs measure on these on the space of configurations. So we need to define first an energy functional. And the energy is defined exactly as you would define it for an O(n) model. We have a gradient term, a kinetic term, and well, now I call it a mass term, but it's also you can think of it as the contribution from a magnetic field. Okay, so what are these two functions? Fw gradient V, this is the one half sum over all the pairs in the volume. W ij. And now here I take the norm of vi minus vj square. That is now the scalar product. Now, if I expand these and they use the fact that the v have all norm minus 1, what I obtain is minus, actually there is now no half, sum over I, different from j, wij, 1 plus the scalar product of vi with vj. It looks very much what you would have for O(n) models. Now the mass term, m epsilon d, it's very similar, but now instead of one of the two points is a fixed direction. So this is 1/2 sum over I in the volume, epsilon I, and here we take vi minus h, vi minus h, where h is a, you can think of it as a, the direction of a magnetic field, and is the vector 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, which has norm 1, minus 1, hh equals minus 1. Okay, once again, when we expand, what we obtain is minus sum over I, epsilon I, 1 plus VI scalar H. And now if we expand, if you now write explicitly what is the scalar product, what you obtain is sum over I, epsilon I, the Z component, minus 1. Now remember, if I go up a moment, that Z equals plus square root of 1 plus something. So this term is always larger or equal than 0, since Z is larger or equal than 1. Forget it, plus the Grassmann part. Okay, so now I have an energy, and now I can try to define a Gibbs measure. So we define, this is not a true Gibbs measure, a finite volume. Measure. So it's defined as you would define a finite volume Gibbs measure. D mu, it depends on all the parameters, on the volume, V equals product over all J in the volume, D Vj, E minus H lambda of V. And now, what is dvj? Well, if we were in the O(n) model, this would be the surface measure on the surface of the sphere. Here, it is the invariant measure on the nonlinear manifold H22. And actually, it's written in this way, dv, let me just write it for one, where dv is dx. Now remember, z is a function of x, y, xi, and eta. So there are only four variables, two real, I have to divide by 2 pi, and two Grassmann, so the corresponding integral can be written as derivatives, eta. And there is a Jacobian, a sort of Jacobian that takes care of the fact that we are on a nonlinear manifold, and that's 1 over z, which is a function of x, y, xi, and eta. Okay. So with this, it doesn't look like it's now the scalar product, it is not a positive bilinear form. Still, the moment you are on this nonlinear manifold, everything becomes well defined. H is positive, I can define my integral, and everything works. So we can define now a super average. So if I take some observable, that must be integrable. So this average is given by the integral over h to 2, the volume of the product over j, dvj, e minus h lambda of v times the observable. Okay. Okay, so now you could ask yourself why the hell should we study this model, so a little bit of history. This model was introduced by Wilbauer in 91. And the motivation was to construct a toy model for quantum diffusion. But actually, later it was realized that it is not a toy model at all. It is it describes a stochastic process with memory. And from that moment, there was more and more interest on this model, especially in the probability community, in the community of probabilities. So actually, if you perform first a change of coordinates, you have two new bosonic and two new fermionic variables. You integrate out the Grassmann variables. The Grassmann. Well, what you obtain is the mixing measure for a history-dependent stochastic process. Well, I don't think I have time to explain really this model, but so this is the so-called vertex reinforced jump process. It was introduced by Werner around 2000. And what happens in this process, it is more likely to jump back to sites where you already spent a lot of time. So you are reinforced towards places that you have already visited a lot. Now, this process has a nice feature that it can be represented as via JP is a random walk in a random environment. And this mixing measure is the probability measure for the random environment. And so knowing properties about this mixing measure, you can deduce a lot of properties of the stochastic process. And actually it turns out that understanding this toy model tells you important properties of the stochastic process. And you can prove properties of the stochastic process. Okay, so actually, just to say the story doesn't stop here, you can now define extensions of H to 2. Now I probably write something wrong, but it's, you take more bosons and more fermions, and these models have a probabilistic interpretation. So for a particular choice of M and N, you obtain a model for a random spanning forest. Okay. So there is now, it's impossible to really explain. There are a lot of results on these different models and the relations and so on. So what I can give you a list of people, groups of people who worked on this problem and developed this problem. Okay, so the first works on H2O2 were done by me together with Tom Spencer and Martin Zielbauer. But later on, there was a lot of work done by the group of Sabot, Perez, and then Fiorin Zeng, and now more recently from the same group, Hu De Vigne, and Valentin Rapin. There is then what I was doing with Franz Merkel and Silke Rolles. And then there is a lot of development was done by Roland Bauerschmidt. Tyler Helmuth. Andrew Swan and Nicolas Crawford. Oops. In particular, they are the ones who developed these extended models and this HMN and worked on this random spanning forest problem. Okay, so now a little bit of heuristics about this model. What do we expect? So to understand what we expect, I should talk for a second about something else. Remember, to define this model, if I go up, what we needed is we have these spins leading on H22, and then the energy is defined. Depending on, so the parameters are this weight W and these spinnings epsilon. Okay, so now let's consider a random walk, a standard random walk. Xn, n in n on Zd. With weights W. So that means that the probability that xj equal sorry, xn plus 1 equal j, knowing that xn equals I is given by the weight wij divided by the sum of all k different from I, W, IK. And this is a process without memory. Okay, so now here is the conjecture, which is really motivated by the connection with the stochastic process. So assume the random walk with weight W is recurrent. That means your process will come back infinitely often to the starting point. Well, in that case, what you expect is that the corresponding stochastic process via JP is also recurrent. Which is not obvious at all. And this should imply that H22 is in a disordered phase. Which means the spins have no correlation. If the random walk is transient. So that means you escape at infinity. There is a positive probability that you will never come back. Well, then you expect a phase transition. So if the weights W are all large, so if you think about statistical mechanics, that means you are at low temperature. Well, then you expect that the VRJP is also transient. And H22 is in an ordered phase, where the spins try to be aligned. If W is very, very small, this corresponds to high temperature, then you expect VRJP to be recurrent and H22 to be in a disordered phase. Okay, is there any proof of all this? Well, the fact that Xn, whenever Xn is recurrent, then VRJP is recurrent was recently proved. It's pretty recent. There were partial results, but now there is a proof that whenever Xn is recurrent, then the last implication is not so immediate. So it seems reasonable. It's probably true, but there's no clear proof of this. For the second part, Xn transient, then there is a phase transition. There is only something has been proven, something not. So this is partially proved. Okay, but now to now see what are the results. Now the first question should be, so since all should depend on the fact that this random walk is recurrent or not, when is this random walk recurrent? And this is a well-known fact. Well, I will now take a special choice. I will assume that my weights are translation invariant. So set Wij to be a function of the distance between I and J. And we can take some, let's say, the infinity distance. And W is some function mapping going from one, because the minimal distance now is one, up to infinity. Ah, sorry, yes, and mapping in two, so W could be zero. So, okay, so now for this choice, there are results. So it's known that if you are in dimension one and two, and the W's decay fast enough, so what we need is that W of R is smaller than, I can take any constant I want here, but I need a decay R to the power 2D. So in particular, you can take W to be non-zero only for nearest neighbors. So that would be the standard random walk. Okay, then in all these cases, it's known that the random walk is recurrent. And this works for any choice of W you take. Now, in the opposite case, when the dimension is one and two, but the weights are long range enough, so decay slowly enough. So if you are in, maybe I write down because I need a little bit more space. So now if, so either we are in dimension one and two, and we need that value, so where is the threshold? So we need this at least to grow as log 1 plus x, divide, sorry, r divided by r to the 2d. So any power smaller than 2D works, but you can get really to the power 2D with a log correction. Then in that case, the random walk is transient. Ora you can be in dimension large or equal than 3, and then all you need is that you are at least you have at least the nearest neighbor jumps. The standard random walk is already transient. And then you have the same. Okay. So then whenever the weights in dimension 1 and 2 don't grow too much, we expect a disorder phase for H22. And when they grow very slowly in dimension 1 and 2, or we are in dimension 3 and higher, then we expect H22 to see to have a phase transition. Okay, so now let's see some results. What I'm going to write here are results really on H22. There are many, many more results on the VRGP, on the stochastic process. Of course, the problem is always to study what happens when the volume goes to infinity. Okay. For D larger equal than 3 and the nearest neighbor jumps, so then this is W bar R equal 1. Exactly. Then you can show there is a phase transition. And so what happens is that if W bar is very, very small, now there is a con, it's really just there is only this constant, this parameter, then we are in a disordered phase. And if W bar is very, very large, we are in an ordered phase. Okay, but what can we really say about this ordered phase? We can say something, but not as much as you would like. So what you can really say is that if W bar is very, very large, then the spins are approximately aligned. Independently of the volume. If in addition, you say that epsilon j, the pinning, is constant, and it's larger than 1 over the volume, that we, if you could get there, we would be very happy. We cannot get to 1 over the volume to the power 1. We have here something a bit smaller than 1. Well, then, not only the spins are aligned, but they are all approximately aligned with the magnetic field. Okay. These was proved in a couple of papers in collaboration with Tom Spencer and Martin Tierbauer. And this goes back to 2010. Okay, so what I'm going to talk today is some generalization of this result to a much more general situation when you have long-range jumps. So take D larger or equal than 1 and long-range interaction. So what you need to require is that W of R is larger or equal than some constant log of 1 plus R to the power alpha divided by R to the power 2D, and need alpha to be strictly larger than 3. Now, in case, since now it's a bit above, so I'll go back for a second. So remember that if the weight grows at least like log divided by r to the 2d, then the random walk is transient in dimension 1 and 2, and also in dimension 3, because in that case it's transient even for nearest neighbors. So you see that actually what we get very, very near to the boundary, except that we have log to a power which is not 1, it's larger than 1. It's at least, we need something larger than 3. Okay, so what can we prove in this case? So then if W bar is very, very large, and we take epsilon j to be of this form, sum over k, not in lambda, wjk. And now if I use the decay of w, I see that this is something which is larger than w bar, a constant divided by the volume to the power 1 minus delta, for any delta larger than 0. Because the correction is only logarithmic. So we can get almost to 1 over lambda, up to a log correction. Okay, so fixing these, we can prove that, I'm not precise about in what we mean by these, I should be precise, so that Vj is approximately parallel to H for all J. And this is a recent... It actually came out a month ago or something like this. Actually, what we were doing is mostly we were really interested in proving transients of the VLGP. But actually, to prove it, you have to prove that the spins are approximately aligned. Okay, now the key tool to prove this result is to compare this model with a hierarchical model. And that's what I'm going to talk now. So the strategy is to compare H22 with on ZD with H22 on a hierarchical on a complete graph with hierarchical interaction. Okay, and then we study the hierarchical model. And it turns out that the hierarchical model has a very, very nice simplifications. And that's the reason why we can get better results than just in the nearest neighbor case. Okay, so hierarchical H22. Okay, so now forget ZD and fix some n larger than 1 and take as volume the set of leaves in a binary tree. You don't need more than that. With n levels. So, which means that the number of leaves is 2 to the n. Okay, and so for example, this would be the case n equal 2. Okay, now we consider H22 on this graph. So, on lambda n. And now we have to decide what are the weights associated to each pair and to each point. So widths, so W, now the W here has nothing to do with the W before. Now this is a function of the hierarchical distance between I and J in lambda n, and now here I define the model really only on a finite volume. And epsilon j is defined as epsilon, a constant epsilon, positive. Okay, so now what can we prove? So the main result is the following. Assume W of R is larger or equal than some constant R to the alpha divided by 2 to the power 2R. And actually, this is just the same condition we asked before, but now we replaced R by 2 to the R. And this must hold for all R in N. And now we need a condition also on the epsilon. So we assume that the epsilon is larger or equal than W bar n to the alpha divided by 2 to the n. So what is this? This is W bar log of the volume, actually the 2 log to the power alpha divided by the volume. So once again, it's almost 1 over the volume, but with a log correction. And alpha is larger than 3. Okay. Then, if W bar is large enough, Vj is approximately aligned with H for all J. And this is the bound you have is uniform in N. Okay. Instead of now, I could make all this more precise, but I think it's more interesting to have a little idea now, I have so much time, of what is the strategy, because that's where you see what is the advantage of working with in this hyperbolic, in this hierarchical setting. So, what is the strategy? So, what we do is we do block spin renormalization. But actually, we do it only on blocks that do not contain the observable. And the very nice feature here is that thanks to the symmetries, you can do the block spin renormalization step exactly. So what we do is block spin at G. So at the end, we obtain an effective model with renormalized coefficients. And once we are there, well, what we do is that we have to study this effective model. And for that, we need a combination of word identities plus conditional estimates. And this part is inspired by the tools used in the previous results with Dinsbauer and Spencer. But actually, it turns out that in our case, the problem is much easier. Okay, so let's see how this block spin algae works. And I think that's all I will have time to explain. So to simplify, let's take we have just n equal 4. Because then we can see explicitly what happens. Take n equal 4, so n lambda, sorry, n equal, what am I right? Not 4, 2. And so that here we have just 4 points. Okay, so we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and this, it is 1 prime, 2 prime, and here we have the origin. Assume now the observable is only in the first point here. So assume O is only a function of V1. So the claim is that I can now take 3 and 4 and replace them by an effective variable attached to the point 2 prime. Okay, so and we can do this really exactly. So we can replace V3 plus V4 over 2 by a new variable V2 prime. And the nice thing is that, well, in principle, this sum does not belong on the nonlinear manifold any longer. But when you write this identity as in terms of integrals, it turns out that V2 prime will also live on H22. Okay, let's see. So the claim is that if I integrate over H22 on 4 variables, here a product of a j, 1 to 4, dvj, and here we have h of w epsilon of the 4 variables, and here I have my observable, v1. This is the same as integrating over 3 variables still on the nonlinear manifold. Now I have v1, v2, and now I have v2 prime. This is my new vector, which is now integrating again on the nonlinear manifold. And here above, I have a new effective h, which has exactly the same form as the initial one. There are no additional terms, but we only have renormalized coefficients. V1, V2, V2 prime, and the observable still in V1. Okay, that's the claim. And what are these renormalized coefficients? So W prime 1, 2 doesn't change. It's just W1, 2. And W prime 1, 2 prime equals, now this is the same as W prime 2, 2 prime. The two points have the same interaction with 2 prime, and it makes sense because they are both, these two points are both at the same hierarchical distance from 2 prime. And this is equal to twice W1, 3. And now note that because of the hierarchical structure, if I have here 1, 2, 3, 4, W1, 3 equals W1, 4, equals W2, 3 equals W2, 4. So I can take any of these. And this is now multiplied by 2. For the pinning, epsilon j prime equals epsilon j for 1 and 2, and epsilon 2 prime is twice epsilon 3. Okay, well, actually, it's a constant. So here is epsilon, here is 2 epsilon, because this was a constant. And actually, if you now you repeat, if you have a larger tree, you can repeat this. So suppose, I give another example, I have more points and my observable is here. Okay, then I see that these two points can be replaced by an effective variable here, which is still in H22, and the W is now multiplied by 2, and the epsilon is multiplied by 2. The same holds for these two points and these two points. But now here there is no observable, so once again I can put the two together and have a new point where now I have 2 square W, 2 square epsilon. So at the end, we obtain a 1D chain after forgetting a few points. Oops. Where the observable is here, and these are the points, this point, this point, and the weights now are growing. Here I have W, 2W, 2 squared W, and so on. So what you obtain is a 1D model with non-homogeneous weights. And this simplifies a lot the analysis. The fact that these weights are growing simplifies a lot the analysis. Okay, maybe I still have 2 minutes, or I didn't hear anything.
Think it's already 15 minutes.
I still cannot hear you. Speak too low.
Can you hear me, Margherita?
Now, yes.
Yes, I think you're over the 50 minutes, so if you can conclude.
Okay, then I will stop here. Okay, then I think this is a good point to stop. So it's good. It was planned so that even if I have time, I could explain a little bit how to get this computation, but otherwise, this is a perfect point to stop. Okay, so the message is that in this particular model, since we have additional symmetries, these between bosonic and fermionic variables, the block spin renormalization group step is exact. And this helps a lot then in the subsequent computations. Okay, so I stop here. Thank you very much.